Behind me is Silverhill Colliery, February 1993. Dave Dale, who's a winder at this colliery, kindly agreed to let me into the engine house and show me the ropes, as it were, if you pardon the pun. To my mind, the main part of a colliery is the shafts. They're there first, when the colliery is first sunk, and they are the last things to be done at the colliery, the filling of the shafts. Other things can change underground, faces and methods of mining, but the shafts that were first sunk are the existing shafts right up to the last day.
Note how quickly the drum can stop under electrical braking. You don't get much quicker than that.
Dave, I know this is a bit unrehearsed, but I just want to ask you a few questions. What's your trickiest moment since you've been driving?
Well, actually, it wasn't on this engine. It was on number one engine. We had a malfunction in the electronics, and the engine, what ratio the speed of it, went wrong, and it went into overspeed. And it took something like 4 hours to get that engine to bank after that had occurred. But all the safety features on the engine worked.
Yeah.
And there's numerous safety features on my engine, but they are all tested regularly, and they did work.
Yeah. Do you ever think about what happened at Markham?
Yes, I've got quite a lot of literature on that. I've got the full report.
Yeah.
The main thing about that is the winder was not to blame.
No.
And being a winder, that was my concern.
Yeah, yeah. It was a rod that broke.
It was a rod that cracked.
Yeah, from the brake pad, yeah. Weren't it?
And it was what they call a single-acting break.
Yeah.
Which meant if that rod went, there was no braking. And since then, all wind engines that were single-acting had to be put on a dual action.
Yeah.
There was secondary brake.
Yeah, so at least some good came out on it, if you could say that. But the winder, didn't he switch the power off?
What he did, he banged the main to stop him, which should have clamped the brake on.
Yeah.
But since it was a brake rod that had broken, that was
That's it.
It didn't work.
Yeah. A lot of men killed, weren't they, on that occasion?
I think it was 18, I'm not sure, if I remember right.
Yeah, everybody's nightmare, isn't it, when you travel a shaft? Yeah.
But they are one of the safest means of transport that there is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Number two shaft, I can say it's got one of the smallest motors for a winder that I've ever known. This being the motor, it's only 200 horsepower. And when you think it will lift 32 men, or approximately 4.5 tons of the shaft, I don't think it's a bad job, even though it does wind slow. It's around about 13 foot a second. The drum, as we can see here, is the blade. That controls most of the safety devices. The overwind, overspeed, most malfunctions are registered by that internal strip of the winder out. All operations on the winder are monitored by computer, and it's sort of like a tachograph or a black box in an aeroplane. Even the fact that you take the brake off is monitored. Every inch you move, direction, any malfunctions, overspeed, overwind, flat roll, is all monitored, and can be brought back from the computer and even give a graphic printout of what's occurred.
So if you make a mistake then, Dave?
Yeah, they know who's made it.
They know who's made it.
When?
Well. Yeah, so.
this is the recorder that Dave was on about. I just noticed the lights change as he starts the motor on.
Thank you. the door through it.
Now to move it in manual speed. Power handle and forward power. Brake off. Move the engine away. The rope speed in between on this dial here. 5 feet per second. 10. 15. Move up now to 18, 19 feet per second. People might be noticing that there are no signals given. This is due to the fact that I'm winding in the shaft. I'm not running from bit bottom to bank, so no signals are necessary. The engine will put off, slow down, or reduce in power.
Slow speed of this
truck. In certain cases, when delicate operations are being carried out in the shaft, the drum has got to move very, very slowly. I've now selected what we call creep speed, and if the lettering on the drum is looked at, we should see just how slow the drum is moving.
Here we are in the mountain, place where I work. I'm going to show you now.
These are some of the places, some of the scenes, some of the working rooms in the lab.
So, Rome, when it knew it was a dying field, management tried to get the men rallied by sticking posters up such as this. Main entrance to the lamp room was via a tunnel at each end. This is at the opening of one of those tunnels, and this is the main one entrance. This is what we call a flame lamp room, and we've kept all the flame lamps. In the flame lamp room, just basic equipment. There's a cleaning brush at one end of the lathe that you can see in the middle of the picture, and a buffing brush at the other. And looking at the lamp room from the other main exit or entrance, the other tunnel, this is a shot of the main workroom, and it's now the beginning of February, and remember this place was closed in October. And this is just a shot of some of the things in our lamp room. These are AFDs, automatic fire damp detectors. They were taken underground for detecting methane gas. What you see now are the yellow boxes, the electricians, testers, circuit testers, etc. What you see now is one of the most vital pieces of equipment, the radio. In my case it was anyway. This is our own phone. It's at Snap Room. Now then, guess which one's my locker? Particular interest in Lennox. Right, this is a kitchen area, pretty basic. What we called it, Ellen. Had a still for making distilled water ourselves. the main tunnel. See what we can see. The subway. The land at the bottom that usually floods right rains. And the stairs are dark cold air. Right from the top. The office. Town office. And the best one to look it out. The entrance to the back, where the last filled their water bottle, put one of the down. The back, this is what's called the edge side. The inside. Showers and soap.
Behind me is number one and number two shaft, Silverhill Colliery, February 1993. In my opinion, one of the most important, if not the most important part of the pit, is the shafts. They were here when the pit was first sunk, the first thing that happened. And they'll be here right up to the last day. It is the last job to be done, the filling of the shafts. Dave Dale has kindly allowed me to come into the winding engine house of both shafts and show me how to go on with the job. We'll start off with number two shaft. That's behind me is number one and number two shafts, Silverhill Colliery. To my mind, the shafts are the most important part of the colliery. They allow the air to go down, the materials to come up, and of course the coal. Behind me is number one and number two shafts, Silverhill Colliery. Behind me is Silverhill Colliery, 1993, February.
Shall I open the window?
Go on then.
I'm all cold there. How they do that again?
You're finishing day, you? I'm not camera shy, you know. Aren't you frightened of breaking it? You don't want me to tell you what to do you?
Dave! Just climb through that window, will you?
Just to practice with blur on top, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Here at Silverhill, the news in the colliery is definitely going to close. It's beginning to sink in.
This is the bit, remember, which was at the centre of the fight against the pit closure programme. Rebel Tory MPs have rallied here, and Roy Link spent a week underground in protest. Joining now is the Union Branch Secretary of the Sea. Here at Silverhill, the news that the colliery is definitely going to close is beginning to sink in. This was the pit, remember, which was at the centre of the fight against the pit closure programme. Rebel Tory MPs rallied here, and Roy Link spent a week underground in protest. Joining me now is the UDM branch secretary, Bert Sage. Mr. Sage, what is the mood here today?
Well, the mood is very, very despondent. I mean, the announcement by Mike Lessell down today is no more than we expected anyway. We didn't expect him to come down and do anything for the mining industry. We ought to just go for that.
Was the fight a waste of time?
I don't think it's been a waste of time because it's kept some bits open. Fortunately, it looks like Silver won for one of them, but at least it's done some good somewhere. Let's hope. Quite honest, I don't think it's done a lot of help anyway. It's a mothball, it wouldn't help.
He made no mention of the 10th threat, is that the same?
Well, all he's saying is that it's got to go through the consultation period, but we don't even know what that means. It's never mentioned us. Lord Justice Lytle in January said that we've got to go through the modified colliery review procedure or something similar. I'm assuming now that that's what we're going to have to go through.
Sage, thank you very much indeed. Well, the closure of the pit here at Silverhill means there's just one pit left in the Ashfield area. A decade ago, there were 10. So what is the future for the Ashfield area without coal? Our industry correspondent, John Brain. One of the agencies which will have to help to revitalise this area is Nottinghamshire County Council. Joining me now is the Deputy Leader, Martin Gowith. Mr Gowith, Mr Heseltine announced the establishment of a regional bundled organisation here in Nottinghamshire. Thank you.
Little bundle. There are already RDOs in the north and south Wales and Westmorland. There's still massive unemployment for the response.
So what do you want to see from the
government?
Demoralised Silverhill, it's back to Cathy in Nottingham.
Central Yorkshire.
Yes.
What I introduced you was Nottinghamshire County Council, no, something.
I trust that you heard me wrong.
Deputy Leader.
Deputy Leader.
I'll write
it. That's the sort of thing.
Yes, yes, that's right.
So we're right, are you?
Yeah, which way we went back that way?
Well, all right, well, we're going to go to the pub and watch jelly for 10 minutes.
Can I have a full call from your office?
Yeah, of course you can.
Thank you. take you off, gentlemen. Very much. Yeah.
All right.
But he made no mention at all, did he, of the centre?
Yeah. Oh. No, no, I mean,
it's just like this assumption that they're going to close.
See ya. See ya. See ya, Bert. See ya. See ya.
Yes, it's in my
cameras.
I'm just taking you for final time.
Final time, is that it?
Are
we done? That's it, time I've been on one more, isn't it? Do you want me to do something?
No, hold on. Hold on.
Headlines at 6 o'clock. 19 of Britain's threatened 31 coal pits are to close or be mothballed. 6,000 miners will lose their jobs this year. 8,000 have already taken redundancy. The President of the Board of Trade, Michael Heseltine, says British coal's future should be settled in the marketplace. Labour say it's a short-term subsidy and a long-term betrayal. In the coal fields, there's anger and relief. We have reports from Grindthorpe in Yorkshire, which is closing, and Bilsthorpe in Nottinghamshire, which stays open.
Tonight's other headlines, terrorists have shot dead.
Consistent with economic realities and legal constraints, we increase the opportunities for British coal. It is now for British coal to make the most of these opportunities. The outcome will be settled, and it should be, in the marketplace.
6 months ago, British Coal was mining at 51 pits, most of them in the Midlands and Yorkshire. Under Michael Heseltine's original plan, announced last autumn, 31 of those pits would close. This afternoon, Mr. Heseltine told the Commons that he now proposed that 12 of the 31 would stay open. Wearmouth, Bentley, Frickley, Hatfield, Kiverton Park, Prince of Wales, Markham Rufford, Bilsthorpe, Calverton, Point of Ayre and Silverdale. British Coal will continue to look for extra sales for these pits. Mr. Heseltine proposed the mothballing of a further six pits, Bevercotes, Clipston, Easington, Rossington, Shirebrook and Westow, in case of any further upturn in the demand for coal. And reserves at Maltby in Yorkshire will be placed on development work in case it's needed again. But the review didn't cover the 10 pits which have already ceased production and which British Coal has said must close within the next 3 months. Betters, Tafmerthyr, Cotgrave, Silverhill, Grindthorpe, Houghton Main, Markham Main, Parkside, Trentham and Vane Tempest. And British Coal will hold consultations on the closure of two further pits, Bolsover and Charleston.
For Michael Heseltine, this was a...
lose their jobs this year, 8,000 have already taken redundancy. The president of the Board of Trade, Michael Heseltine, says British coal's future should be settled in the marketplace. Labour say it's a short-term subsidy and a long-term betrayal. In the coal field, there's anger and relief. We have reports from Grindthorpe in Yorkshire, which is closing, and Bilsthorpe in Nottinghamshire, which stays open.
Tonight's other headlines, terrorists have shot dead.
Consistent with economic realities and legal constraints to increase the opportunities for British coal. It is now for British coal to make the most of these opportunities. The outcome will be settled, as it could be, in the marketplace.
6 months ago, British coal was mining at 51 pits, most of them in the Midlands and Yorkshire. Under Michael Heseltine's original plan, announced last autumn, 31 of those pits would close. This afternoon, Mr. Heseltine told the Commons that he now proposed that 12 of the 31 would stay open. Wearmouth, Benfield, Frickfield, Hatfield, Kiverton Park, Prince of Wales, Markham Rufford, Bilsthorpe, Calverton, Point of Ayre and Silverdale. British Coal will continue to look for extra sales for these pits. Mr. Heseltine proposed the mothballing of a further six pits, Bevercoats, Clipston, Easington, Rossington, Shirebrook and Westo, in case of any further upturn in the demand for coal. And reserves of Maltby in Yorkshire will be placed on development work in case it's needed again. But the review didn't cover the 10 pits which have already ceased production and which British Coal has said must close within the next 3 months. Betters, Taffmerthyr, Cotgrave, Silverhill, Grindthorpe, Houghton Main, Markham Main, Parkside, Trentham and Vane Tempest. And British Coal will hold consultations on the closure of two further pits, Bolsover and Charleston.
Ian.
They're just going to get back with his tackle.
Look at this. A man barely alive. Yeah, I'm talking over it now. Is that it for today?
What?
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it for me today. I'm done.
We're not being
on,
Fred.
Leave.
Cash, you've got wheels going round.
I've done. Just spun round.
And once you have to go home. Thank you. It's only candy camera, you know.
Hey?
Candy camera.
Oh, my dear.
Not bad to beat, because I put music over it, Doug, so you're all right. Hey up, Tony.
Hello there, we'll see you in. Good luck. Good
luck. You know where he's lying.
Catch me. You said, don't you?
missing.
You can do all your bloody hands this time.
They've been 3 weeks on this. 3 weeks.
In here and fetch keys from the wall. Right, thank you.
The last time?
Number two shaft.
The last time on shaft?
Yeah, there's not many men still here, you know.
No. You'll not get down there again, Kedge?
No.
And do you all your bloody life?
That's right, we're done now.
Shame, isn't it?
Yeah, it's shame. Good old country rule.
30,000 ton cage.
30,000 ton?
Yep.
What? In one shaft?
Yeah. There's about 60,000 tons on in both of them, I think. Something like that.
That's a sad day for you.
Hmm. Yep. See daylight up there. one at Roll Poles.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, ooh, straight out of it. Got camera shack. Oh, well. Goodbye, Silverhill.
Goodbye, Silverhill.
That's all that's left to with one chap. Not your lot, eh?
No.
Can I go upstairs?
Well, can you get up?
Okay.
Was that the careless from it?
Down the bone shaft. What's left on it? Are you all right? Hold it if you want. Let me tell you. No,
it's all right, it's
moved to bed a bit. And that's bunker, hopper. What coal used to go in. It's full of rubbish now. Have a look up, you get a better view. Head gear up. Now that's guide ropes hanging, just cooking, you see. Let's go in. Same again. And it took a week to fill it.
What, the shaft?
Yep, just a week. God knows how long it took to dig it out.
Now, come, let us not get wrong, and come by the way, I get the dog on you.
Thank you. Thank you. Old Frost. Mansfield pitch is right over there, Mick. Point it out over there.
All right.
How's Presley look, Mick?
Yeah.
Sure. That's how the English to cast now, woman. Take it really been out, look.
Send this, mate.
Yeah. You're all right, kid. There's no... No one's going to drop on you or else hold to roll him.
Alright. Tell you what, it used to be the place I used to stand. I used to put the living chair.
Aye. And many folks has run all that.
Thank you.
Just give me that, Mr. Whitflag.
Where are you? Might as well now we've been here a bit.
Who brought you up?
That's it, I think. He's gone with flag here, I think. Thank you.
Well, it's 25th of June 1994, and it's going on towards end of day, 10 past 9, which is very fitting for this video. I started the video here, stood here, looking at the shafts behind us. They've gone now, and so has everything else that's of any importance to a colliery. We've all got memories of Silverhill. Everyone that's worked here, we've all got a story to tell. I started here when I was 15. My first day was spent at Silverhill, my first working day. I got married here. I had both my kids while I worked here. I bought my house, I had a car. I lost both parents while I worked here. A very good friend of mine, Brian Brown's, got killed here. As I say, we've all got stories to tell. Like the times when, during the strike, the NUM strike, we were coming up here on buses that were boarded up with wire mesh. This car park was full of pickets. But, as you can see, it's all over. It's definitely over now.